The satirical magazine Simplicissimus was founded by the publisher Albert Langen in Munich in 1896. It was published weekly, and from the very first edition it boasted many of Germany's finest illustrators on its covers and in its pages. One of the most significant and enduring of these was Thomas Theodor Heine, whose precise linear images appeared with great frequency. As was common practice at the time, his illustrations and those of his fellow contributors were drawn directly onto lithographic stones, occasionally with additional limited colour runs. Heine was undoubtedly the most senior staff artist at this time, but he was joined by others, including Wilhelm Schultz and Reinhold Max Eichler, both of whom featured regularly. Bruno Paul began to appear a year or so later, and he had a particularly modernist, generally flat graphic approach. And although far from alone, he was nevertheless responsible for a definite move away from the norms of crosshatch and lithographic shading, as seen in the folk fantasy imagery of the Norwegian Theodor Kittelsen and the textual social satires of Edward Tony. The result was a truly eclectic mix of styles with no single dominant approach, although it continued to be Heine who was by far the most widely used illustrative talent at this time. Although it enjoyed considerable popularity with the German public, the dissident editorial tone and scathing satirical illustrations which were the magazine's stock in trade rendered it considerably less popular with the authorities. And although not actually banned, posters advertising the latest issues were frequently torn down by the police. And in 1898, a joke on the cover about the Kaiser's visit to Palestine resulted in Albert Langen being fined 30,000 gold marks, and both Heine and the writer Frank Wedekind were imprisoned for 6 months. Albert Langen spent the next 5 years in exile in Switzerland, but the magazine continued to defiantly make fun of the shortcomings of those in power, even if they now understandably steered clear of mockery of the Kaiser himself. Around the turn of the century, colour printing featured more frequently, at least on the covers, and at this time the group of regular illustrators were joined by Ferdinand von Reznicek and Rudolf Wilke, both of whom would also have a significant presence in the coming decade. Having been somewhat chastened by the recent punitive measures taken against them, the overall tone of both the written and drawn content became understandably more cautious and less political, for a while at least. And in the early years of the century, the pool of illustrators was augmented by Danish-born Olaf Gulbrandsen, whose distinctively styled images would continue to be a significant presence in the magazine until its eventual demise. In 1906, Simplicissimus was considered to have crossed the line again, and the editor Ludwig Thoma was imprisoned for 6 months for his repeated attacks on the clergy. And although it would have been little comfort to him as he served his sentence, the magazine's controversial stance made it more popular than ever, with a circulation of about 85,000 copies. By this point, the publisher Albert Langen had returned from Switzerland, only to be confronted by Heine and the other writers and illustrators, who demanded a profit-sharing scheme, and the retention of copyright in their own works. And faced with the possible departure of his entire talent pool of illustrators and writers, Langen reluctantly agreed to their demands. Not much later, the work of some younger illustrators also began to appear, among them Erich Schilling, who would become another frequent contributor to the very end of the magazine's existence, and Norwegian Ragnvald Blix, whose drawn style was similar to that of his countryman Olaf Gulbrandsen. And it turned out that new blood was very much needed, as by 1909 Ferdinand von Reznicek and Rudolf Wilke had died, and so had the publisher Albert Langen. Heinrich Kley also began having work published around this time, most of which was reprinted from his existing body of drawings, and the popularity of his less politically inclined absurdist images with the readers ensured he would continue to feature regularly for some time to come. For the next few years, the visual content of the magazine continued to be of a high standard. Colour was increasingly prevalent, and in general, Simplicissimus confined itself to social satire. But there were also the occasional graphic warnings about the growing global threat of war. And in the years before the outbreak of the First World War, Simplicissimus was broadly opposed to Germany's aggressive foreign policy and made no secret of its opposition. But once war was declared in 1914 and fighting began, the magazine ceased to be a voice of dissent and gave way to patriotic support for the war effort. The focus of the magazine's satires and condemnations shifted away from the German political, military and religious authorities, and its primary target was now the Allied forces and their leaders. And the graphic strength and potency of the hostile images created during the war were a vital propaganda tool for the Kaiser, whether justified or not. Somewhat incongruously, alongside these more stridently belligerent images, there were also quite a few which appeared to be genuine graphic laments for the horrific realities and consequent loss of life. And even in the midst of this ongoing carnage, Heinrich Kley and one or two others continued to produce harmless fantasy-based humour with images completely unconcerned with the conflict. After 4 years and huge losses on both sides, in 1918 Germany was finally forced to surrender and accept the punitive terms of their defeat. And in the desperate years that followed, Simplicissimus returned in the main to the domestic woes of post-war Germany and the widening inequalities between those at the top and those at the bottom of the social structure. That it survived this period at all was a testament to its popularity. Wilhelm Schulze's work remained ubiquitous in the post-war years and eloquently lamented the fate of the German people. And at this time, Alfred Kubin and Kathy Kollwitz, neither of whom were known for humour or frivolity in their work, both made several gloomy appearances. Even so, there were also some creating more frivolous images for the magazine. And although Karl Arnold had made some appearances even before the outbreak of war, it was during the 1920s that he came to the fore using his highly modernist flat graphic style to make more upbeat, if slightly sinister, references to the popular cabaret scene of Berlin and other cities of the time. But the prevailing gloom persisted, and the bleak visceral satires of George Grosz and the more formally drawn but equally grim work of Erich Schilling was also prevalent in the magazine's pages. But however dark and pessimistic the tone of these images, it must be conceded that the by now almost total dominance of graphic modernism in the magazine made for some particularly aesthetically arresting illustrations. The later 1920s was a time of unrest and upheaval in Germany, and there were many increasingly violent confrontations between political factions attempting to gain the upper hand in German politics. Among them, of course, was Adolf Hitler's National Socialist Party, and as he and his supporters became increasingly dominant, Simplicissimus was among other satirical magazines who ridiculed him and his aspirations, although it has to be said they were no less scathing about the opposing far-left side of the equation. But Heine, Karl Arnold and Erich Schilling, among others, were particularly unflattering in their portrayals of the Nazi leader. And images openly mocking him personally featured regularly on the magazine's covers and pages from the late 1920s into the early 1930s. But when Hitler's National Socialists actually came to power in 1933, they wasted no time before entering the magazine's offices and issuing all too believable threats of violence and incarceration against the editorial team. But they didn't ban it, sensing rather shrewdly that it would be better to use the magazine and others for their own ends. Nevertheless, Thomas Theodor Heine, who was Jewish, was forced to resign and went into exile. And others who couldn't face becoming propaganda tools of the regime, including George Grosz, left for the USA and other safe refuges. But most of the major contributors remained and quickly started towing the Nazi party line with varying degrees of enthusiasm, whether genuine or otherwise. And in return for their compliance, they were encouraged to carry on, providing their work was either harmless social humour or ridiculed of the European countries and their leaders. And it was clearly understood by all that there would be no more mockery of the Führer or his ambitions. Consequent, from this point onward, and like all the surviving German satirical magazines, Simplicissimus became another propagandist voice, used to stir up anti-Semitism and hostility to the rest of the world in the minds of the German people. And alongside this more overt hostility, there was an increasing amount of positive imagery involving their fighting forces and the promotion of the swastika flag. Predictably throughout the decade, it was this heavy-handed but largely successful propaganda which became ubiquitous and more outrageous. And when war inevitably did break out in 1939, those who decided to stay with the magazine, and particularly Erich Schilling and Olaf Gulbrandsen, appeared to have had an all too credible change of political stance, and were by now following the party line with considerable zeal in their illustrations. The magazine continued to be published throughout most of the war, and their attacks on the Allied leaders, and Churchill in particular, grew ever more hysterical and supportive of the Führer, as it became increasingly obvious that Germany would lose the war. After an unbroken run of almost half a century, Simplicissimus gave up the ghost in September of 1944, and was followed a few months later by defeat and the death of Hitler and some of his more fanatical associates. But a decade after its apparent demise, in 1954, Simplicissimus was brought back to life by a younger cohort of writers and illustrators whose reputations had not been tarnished through association with the Nazis. Not only did it continue to use the same masthead as its predecessor, but the great majority of the illustrators who featured owed an obvious stylistic debt to the earlier exponents of graphic modernism, such as Heine himself, Karl Arnold and Olaf Gulbrandsen. And although it never achieved the circulation that the first incarnation of the magazine had enjoyed at the height of its popularity, this resuscitated version had a decent run of 13 years before it eventually folded due to falling circulation in 1967. In its time, Simplicissimus had been a highly influential and well-regarded satirical magazine, not least for the quality of the illustrations and cartoons it featured so prominently. And it's a great pity that some of the illustrated content must be viewed through the unpleasant filter of two world wars and the part Germany played in them. But it shouldn't be forgotten that it also, for most of its existence, had been a powerful voice of dissent, which had exposed and condemned the abuse of power, militarism, and the hypocrisy of the church and state. And the many images created for its covers and pages endure as a valuable body of compelling, an eloquent satirical illustration of considerable historical importance.